the Monitor and the Merrimack. Many can recall this alliterative note from our American history class, but few recall just exactly what happened. Fewer still remember the tremendous significance or the brave men who fought in this Civil War slugfest. So let's take a moment to recall this watershed in military eras and to tell the story of an extraordinary piece of American art and the U.S. Navy officer it was presented to, Lieutenant Louis Napoleon Stodder. Born February 12, 1837 in Boston, most of Stodder's documented life begins after he was married in November 1861 and was appointed an acting master in the U.S. Navy on December 26 that same year. Volunteering to serve aboard the USS Monitor, Stodder quickly found himself assigned to the groundbreaking vessel in little over a month. Neither the Monitor nor its adversary were the first ironclad ships, but it was the first such ship commissioned by the U.S. Navy. Made largely in response to reports of a Confederate ironclad, the USS Monitor was a radical ship designed by Swede John Ericsson. Steam-powered, ironclad, and virtually flat to the water with a rotating turret, it presented a minimal target to the enemy. The design was obviously met with skepticism, but when Ericsson promised the ship in just 100 days, the Navy was sold. It was mocked as Ericsson's folly and the cheese box on a raft, and even Stodder, who had volunteered to serve aboard her, expressed his doubts, saying, "She was a rather hasty job," was the Monitor. "You'd better get a good look at her now, as you won't see her after she strikes water. She's bound to go to the bottom of the East River and stick there, sure." But on January 30th, 1862, it slipped its dry dock and launched, with Ericsson standing on its deck. She was 179 feet long, could crew 49 men, and her 320 horsepower engine drew a top speed of under 8 knots. Everything was steam powered, from her prop to her pumps, but her guns were still from the old school. Her round 20-foot turret was plated with iron 8 inches thick, and crouched inside were two 11-inch Dahlgren guns, weighing approximately 8 tons each. Ericsson's rotating turret was a true naval innovation and would soon find itself in international use, far beyond the two nations embroiled in the American Civil War. Stodder's duty aboard the Monitor was the wheel that rotated her game-changing turret, and she wouldn't have to wait long to use it. On March 8, 1862, she arrived in Chesapeake Bay at Hampton Roads in response to the Confederate ironclad ship CSS Virginia wreaking havoc on the flotilla and forcing the Union blockade on Confederate ports. The Virginia was built on the hull of the former USS Merrimack, a steam frigate that the Union had scuttled. Her design was completely different from the Monitor, but her lethal efficacy was not up for debate. Prior to the Monitor's arrival, the Virginia had rammed and sunk the sloop of war USS Cumberland, fired red-hot cannonballs at the USS Congress, setting it ablaze, and had worried the crew of 3 other Union ships so badly, they ran aground trying to escape. Dusk fell before she could finish off the foundered USS Minnesota, and so the Virginia left for rebel waters that evening, planning on returning the next day. She had destroyed 2 Union ships, foundered an additional 3, and killed 400 Navy sailors. Her own losses were just 2 men. That evening, the Monitor arrived with the orders to protect the Minnesota. In a darkness lit by only the still-burning USS Congress, she took her position and awaited the rebels. The next morning, the Virginia moved in for the kill, but found in her path what they believed to be a boiler being towed from their quarry. They soon realized it was the Monitor, and a lengthy naval battle ensued. One can only imagine the conditions inside the Union ship. Stodder wrote of intense heat in the fire room, now compounded by the thunderous impacts of Confederate shells and the massive percussions of their own Dahlgren guns. This continued for 4 hours that must have seemed like days. It was during the fighting that Stodder, located in the turret and controlling its direction, was discussing strategy with two officers. Found leaning against the turret wall, the Monitor at that moment received a direct hit from the Virginia's guns. Stodder was flung across the inside of the turret and knocked unconscious. He was taken below and is said to have required at least an hour to recover. He later wrote, "I was flung by the concussion clean over the guns to the floor of the turret." The rest of the battle, as history tells us, was a draw, each side claiming victory. And while that might have been the last time they battled one another, it was not to be Stodder's last time serving bravely aboard the Monitor. The Union Ironclad continued to serve in the Civil War, including that June where she covered the withdrawal of McClellan's men after their failed attempt to capture Richmond. The conditions were not better in the summer months. Stodder recalls, "It was hell, being 170 degrees in the fire room, and on the berth deck it was 95 degrees. Put into dry dock through November, the Monitor was to be towed to North Carolina on December 30th by the USS Rhode Island. Men soon noticed, quote, "a swell from the southward and gathering gray clouds." Before dinner, the crew was forced below decks by waves breaking over the Monitor. At first confident in their sturdy ship, the crew celebrated their safety despite the storm outside. But at 7:30, one of the tow lines from the Rhode Island snapped, and their safe ship now pitched and rolled dangerously. Water began to pour in through the gaps. Pumps worked frantically, but coal was becoming wet and wouldn't keep the steam engines hot. Larger pumps were used, but it was no use. The storm raged out of control, regularly submerging the forward pilot house. The Ironclad finally signaled to her companion to stop and render aid. The Rhode Island may have stopped, but the storm showed no sign of ceasing. In fact, with pumps having no effect, the Monitor was continually buried by each new wave, only the top of her turret visible. By 10 p.m., the Monitor's fate was sealed. Water was more than a foot deep in the engine room, and the pumps forcing air into the steam engines to keep the fires ablaze began to spit water. Without her engine and pumps, it was only a matter of time. A bucket brigade was started, the men singing as they went, in spite of pending doom and the merciless sea outside. The red distress lantern was finally raised, and the decision was made to cut the remaining tow line so the Monitor wouldn't drag the Rhode Island down with her. Three men volunteered to brave the surface of the soaking, slippery Ironclad in the midst of a terrific nighttime storm to save the lives of those aboard the Rhode Island: John Stocking, James Fenwick, and Master Louis Napoleon Stodder. All three climbed down the turret, but a mighty wave struck, sweeping Stocking and Fenwick over the edge. Stodder was only saved by grabbing the safety lines that encircled the deck. He pulled his way to the remaining tow rope, 13 inches in diameter, and hacked it loose with a hatchet. The Rhode Island sent her rescue boats to the Monitor, but in the chaos, both ships and the rescue boats all threatened to collide with one another. Men wishing to be rescued still had to cross the same nightmare that had already taken two of their comrades. One account describes it as mountains of water rushing across our decks, the howling of the tempest, the bubbling cry of the strong swimmer in his agony, and the whole panorama of horror, which time can never efface from my memory. Stodder remained with the Monitor until its final minutes, venturing back into the ship's pitch-black innards to rescue any remaining crew. The last person he found was engineer Samuel Lewis. Stodder wrote, "I told him the ship was sinking and that he had better take his chances in the open. He refused, however, to do so, and not being strong enough to carry him, I had to leave him to his fate. In all, 47 men were rescued from the Monitor, and 16 followed her to the ocean floor. Stodder's actions were praised by Monitor Commander John P. Bankhead, who wrote, "I would beg leave to call the attention of the Admiral and of the Department of the particularly good conduct of Lieutenant Green and Acting Master Lewis N. Stodder, who remained with me until the last, and by their example did much towards inspiring confidence and obedience on the part of others." The praise was also rightly offered by Rear Admiral Samuel Phillips Lee to Secretary of the Navy Gideon Wells on Stodder's behalf, stating, "Bankhead commends particularly Lieutenant Samuel D. Green, his executive officer, and Acting Master L. N. Stodder as worthy of all praise." For his bravery in the Battle of the Ironclads, and no doubt for his heroics on the Monitor's final voyage, this extravagant Tiffany and Company sword was presented to Lieutenant Louis Napoleon Stodder on February 9, 1863, shortly after his honorable discharge as an acting volunteer lieutenant on January 10th. In the tradition of exceptional American naval swords, this example by the legendary artisans at Tiffany and Company is awash in American imagery and nautical symbolism. The gilded brass hilt is a sweeping sculpture of oak leaves, wreaths, naval ropes, a patriotic shield, anchors, a flying American finial, and of course, its historic inscription. Presented to Lieutenant Lewis N. Stodder by his Boston friends, February 9th, 1863, Monitor. Its pillowed silver grip is wrapped with silver wire, and its 29-inch blade is smothered in floral and scroll etchings, including depictions of a naval officer, a sailor, twisted dolphins, and the figure of Constitution. Its black leather scabbard has miraculously survived to the present day, along with its two gilded brass mounts, each prominently featuring an anchor wrapping around it and oak leaves. Even the shape is gilt and embellished to perfection. This exceptional blade, the heroic Lieutenant Stodder, and his tale of U.S. history deserve to be enshrined in American history books. His surprising bravery in the face of sights, sounds, and events nearly unimaginable to us today is an uncommon virtue in any era. The battles in which he participated changed the face of warfare forever and rang the death knell of the wooden fighting ship in all their savage elegance. His Tiffany and Company sword, as artistic as it is significant, is a living exhibit in steel and gold, but remains a reminder of his valor in a time when steam and iron could rule the world.